everyone and welcome. My name is Jeannie Davison and I'm the Industry Development Manager here at Screenworks. Thank you very much for joining us today for the third of our Gender Matters webinars, which we're very pleased to be collaborating with Screen Australia and the Gender Matters Taskforce on. As a national organisation, I'd like to begin by acknowledging the traditional owners of country throughout Australia, the Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people, including those joining us for our webinar today, and recognise their continuing connection to land, waters and culture. And in particular, I would like to pay my respects to the Ngiyambal people of the Bundjalung Nation, the traditional custodians of the land of the Ballina region, where I'm speaking to you from today. So now it's my very great pleasure to hand you over to your facilitator today, Liz Doran.
Hello and welcome. I am speaking to you from Bondi, so I just want to pay my respects and acknowledge the Gadigal people of the Eora Nation. Pay my respects to elders past, present and living. We have three really amazing women to speak to you today. I know all three of these women and have worked with them and think they're all really terrific. So I'm thrilled to be here to be introducing you to them. Our first speaker is Sarah Bassiuoni. Sarah is a Sydney-based writer. She's currently writing episodes on season two of The Secret She Keeps, developing an original drama series with Matchbox NBCU, and is writing a feature film for Sweet Shop and Green. She got her first broadcast credit in, and I'm going to give you a chance to speak. I feel like I'm doing all of Sarah's bio here, but she's going to tell you the personal stuff. I'm just giving you the credits, which are great. She wrote an episode of The Heights, where she was also the script editor. And in 2019, she directed a six-part narrative comedy series, which is terrific, called Car Park Clubbing, for ABC iView. And importantly, I think to quite a lot of the people attending today, she went and was part of Screen Australia's Developing the Developer program and went on to become an external assessor, as well as doing a placement at Fremantle Media. And she is with me, she's a colleague with me as one of the Gender Matters Taskforce, where she is pretty brilliant. So Sarah, why don't we get the ball rolling? I know that a lot of the people watching today are really curious about how people got their first start as a scriptwriter. And I know you've had a really interesting journey, which I've left some of the secrets out. Why don't we start with talking about how you came to be a screenwriter, a working screenwriter?
Sure. Okay. Hi, everyone. Started out actually as a lawyer. So I was working for this organization called Amnesty International and another organization called Human Rights Defenders, and my job was to monitor protests. And I got a 6-month gig in a very small part of Ireland, a Gaeltacht, so where everybody spoke Irish as their first language. And it's in the very western tip of Ireland. And there was a big protest that had split the community into, because Shell was bringing in a gas pipeline and from offshore and going through a lot of lands. And so like half the community were in favor of it and half were against. And there were all kinds of events occurring around that and protests, you know, from Europe, lots of European activists coming along. And so I was sent there to watch and report interactions with the cops and protesters. And that's kind of my legal background, is in that kind of work and, you know, actions against the police. And so, because it was such a small town, everybody knew who I was. And everybody, of course, had an opinion. So if I left my apartment, the Irish are not backward in coming forward about sharing their opinions, and that made me kind of staying neutral or perceived the perception of staying neutral a bit tricky. So I basically, when I wasn't working, stayed inside my house, which you think is fine, but actually in that part of Ireland, the internet was pretty crap. The TV was very sporadic, as was the radio. And I hadn't really brought like a shit ton of books with me. So I started writing a screenplay. I didn't know, I hadn't even read a play or a screenplay, so I had no idea what I was doing. I was just writing to entertain myself about a comedy about Britain leaving the EU, which I know, like, as if that would ever happen. Yeah. And that was like 2010, I think, or 11. And a mate of mine, her brother-in-law was a director, and she sent it onto him, and he entered it, as straight white men do, with extreme confidence, into a competition with the British Arts Council. And I had no idea. So I was like walking around the streets of Dublin one day, that job had finished, and I get a phone call being like, "Hi, we'd like you to come in for an interview about the TV show you wrote." So yeah, it all kind of started from there. But then I got
So this is just an accidental through adversity story that's how you ended up. But so then did that trigger something for you? Did you think this might be more fun than being a human rights lawyer?
I mean, yes. As fun as being a human rights lawyer was, always feel good. I was like, oh, I can control the outcomes of stories. Great. This is way more fun. But I got my dream job back in Australia, moved back here, continued to be a lawyer for like 4 years. But in the interim, did film school part-time and then decided to quit being a lawyer for a bunch of reasons and give this a red hot crack. And this lovely lady one day showed up in my afters class as a guest. It's Liz, everyone, just letting you know. Basically, I think I unashamedly like fangirled you. And you and Sam Strauss and a couple of other people decided to give me a shot as a note taker. And from there,
out of curiosity for everyone, not that I'm trying to be ageist, but your story is an interesting one because you had a whole other career before you became a screenwriter. How old were you when you went back to film school?
33.
Wow, okay. So that was quite a significant previous career to have and quite a big life change to make at that age.
Yeah, everybody thought I was insane. Right. Like, not even, yeah. I had saved up enough money that I knew I could not work for a few years. And then afters, they gave us the advice that you probably wouldn't earn money for the first 5 years out. It was different, and you had to start at the bottom again. And like I consider myself incredibly lucky. I think I've been very fortunate in getting opportunities. And obviously luck, you know, coincides with hard work sometimes. And so I've kind of risen and have been earning a living for a couple of years, you know, so that's good.
And so those first years, like just after you left film school, what sort of strategies did you have in terms of, you know, finding a way to make those kind of contacts?
Well, I think I was pretty disciplined. So I read a screenplay a day. Wow. Every day I was at film school. Most days. And I wrote a lot. And so I had spec scripts that when someone said, "Oh, can I take a look?" I had them ready to show. I never asked someone before they offered. Mm. Hot tip. Also, I think I was very fortunate in that going to film school did help with those initial introductions. Like, I know my teacher introduced me to Liz, introduced me to a couple of other amazing female writers, and I think all of whom, like the camaraderie in this industry, particularly amongst writers, is pretty phenomenal. And I think people were like, oh, she's a grown up and she's not scared to talk. Let's give her a go.
Yeah. Like, I mean, I feel like I'm interrupt, but I can say from, and I know this is something that you now kind of want people to move away from and sort of not employ you, but the fact that you were a grown up and the fact that you had a previous career as a lawyer and that you'd had a life actually made you quite valuable in people's writers' rooms. So I think I can speak to sort of say that that was a really good in for you.
Oh, totally. And no, I mean, I don't care what gets me in a room. I want to get, I did almost every single room I could possibly get into. I hated turning down a room. As I said, I was in an incredibly privileged position of having saved up funds. So I didn't have to have another job for a while. So this is the thing, when you're starting out, you get very little notice about upcoming jobs and there's no guarantee of income. And so I don't get me wrong, like my privilege there helped me immensely. Sorry, I just seen a question. What's a spec script? A spec script is a script you write on spec, as in you're not getting paid for it. So it can be to an existing show, but more often nowadays it's your own idea, or whether that's a short, a feature, or a TV show. Yeah, so I think those... Yeah, I think I had no problem using any advantage I could. Definitely the legal career helped. Also, my background, my like heritage, my dad's Muslim and Arab, and I lived in Saudi Arabia for the first 5 years of my life, 6 years of my life. So obviously in the current climate, when people are doing stories about Muslims and Arabs, they want to get some authenticity. And so I got into a lot of rooms because of that as well. And yeah, look, that's probably an area we'll get questions about and we can dive into.
We will now. All right. But I think now we might go to Kodie Bedford. She's, and there she is. Kodie, you're still muted, but that was my trick. So Kodie is... Well, it comes from Western Australia, from Geraldton, Gero, to all of us West Australians, with strong family ties to the East Kimberley. She graduated from the UWA and got a master's in creative writing from UTS in Sydney. She's written for Mystery Road, both seasons, I think. I'm looking at her nodding, yep. I've got her CV in front of her face, but yes, both seasons of Mystery Road, which was one of my favourite shows of last year, and also an episode of the Logie Award nominated children's TV show, Grace Beside Me. And most recently, she's been working as a co-writer and EP on a new show called All My Friends Are Racist, which I actually cannot wait to see. She started as a journalist, a cadet journalist for SBS, and then moved to ABC as a researcher for Message Sticks. And since she left the ABC in 2015, Kodie's also worked as a freelance writer and co-founded the Indigenous arts group Cope Street Collective. Kodie.
Hi.
To you. Hello. So what's your pathway to this brilliant career?
Oh, my God. Brilliant. thank you. I don't know. So if I could be half as good as yours, Liz.
You need another 20 years.
Yeah. No. I mean, coming from WA, as you also know, it was any career in the arts just was not even on my mind. It was so far away as a dream. And I wanted to be a screenwriter since I was like 14, and I saw this show called Buffy the Vampire Slayer. And I wanted to be Buffy, as we all did as 14-year-old girls, but then I'm like, oh, someone writes Buffy. I want to do that. And so I looked up what a screenwriter is, and basically...
Were you 14 when you worked out that someone had written Buffy?
Yeah. And I downloaded all the scripts. This is like very early internet days. But you could also go to the bookshop. So I'm from country WA, so... when we'd go to Perth, I'd buy this book, Buffy Scripts. And it was my first kind of what a script looks like. And I think I also bought at the time like Screenwriting for Dummies or something like that. And I was just infatuated with this, what is a screenwriter? I want to do that. I want to make films. But being from country WA, no one does that. You go get a trade or you become a nurse or a doctor. And I was definitely not smart enough for any of those careers. So I thought, what can I do to make sure I still serve that creative side in shaping stories and telling stories? And journalist was kind of the natural fit. So I went to uni, became a journalist. My WA people will get this. My first ever story I was put on was chasing Ben Cousins down the airport. He just got out of rehab in Perth.
I think, and, to be fair, more than WA people.
Yeah. Well, my editor said, and make sure you get what he's wearing. And so that was my big job. And then I thought, it was that moment I actually thought, maybe journalism isn't for me. But I stuck it out. I think I wanted to be a sports journalist. I was really sports mad. And eventually I was just in the Kimberley because I had my family, Aboriginal side are from the Kimberley and Jari mob. And I was just doing nothing there. And a journalist with a video camera, so sparked that kind of film thing, came in and interviewed my nan. And I got talking to her and I said, oh, what do you do? And she said, I'm a video journalist. So I'm like, oh, screen. She got my number and she called me like when she got back to Sydney and said, there's a job going if you want it, or a cadetship. So I did apply for that. And next thing I know, I was like moving to Sydney and I knew nothing about Sydney. And
how old were you at this point when you
moved? I was 24. I had the attitude, my friend always told this story, that when I arrived to Sydney, I went to a cafe and I go, oh, this cafe is really flash because they have Turkish bread. So that was my kind of cultural shock into what Sydney was. And of course, you know, I got to work at SBS and tell all these incredible stories on the road, like magazine style stories for Living Black. And I just craved telling longer and longer form stories. So I just would meet these people in the most remote parts of this country. And I'm like, oh, I don't want to tell a 5-minute story. I want to tell a 20-minute story. So sort of piqued my interest in documentary. And that's kind of why I switched to ABC Message Stick, which was a flagship documentary series. And I got there to be a researcher and work with these incredible directors. It was a great training ground for Indigenous directors. But then when I got there, they're like, okay, and we're cancelling Message Stick. And I thought, what am I going to do? But I was so, I would call it luck or fate or something. Sally Riley just happened to be there and she said, I want to change Indigenous storytelling to not just documentary. I want to do like primetime drama. And she was like working in Redfern now as kind of her like flagship drive. And I just got to be basically an assistant there in the department at the time and
So this is the Screen Australia Indigenous unit with Sally at that point?
Oh yeah. No, this is ABC. She was at ABC.
The ABC.
Yeah, she's at the head of ABC Indigenous. And
now head of ABC pretty much everything.
Now everything, yeah. She's worked hard for it. And she's so
a legend, yeah.
That kind of gave me access to these scripts again. And I just kept reading scripts. Like my dream was sort of sparked again. And it took me a while to work up the courage because of course, you know, leaving a job where you get paid is absolutely terrifying to freelance life and not knowing and starting at the bottom again. But I just had to, I'm like, if I don't take this chance and go. And so I managed to get my first role as a note taker for Liz.
Everything's coming back to me.
Yeah. Well, ready for this, which was my first kind of experience. And Liz, you were so kind. Like, I don't think where this industry we have and the supportiveness of like women, particularly what we do for each other. But what you did for me was you allowed me to like be like, okay, go off and write shadow scenes. And you came over to my house and you went through like, this is great, this is great. You could do better in this and getting this point across. And it just went, I went, oh, this is what I need, like actual guidance on how to write a script. So I really have you to thank because you were the first person to kind of take me under my wing that way. Oh. And, you know, after note taking for so many years, it was Mystery Road that kind of, they needed a writer and I happened to be their note taker. I knew the world. Set in the Kimberley, from the Kimberley, and I went, okay, pick me, and I did, and I probably did terribly. I hate to read that first draft I ever did, but it gave me all I had the training, I did it all with the wonderful team there, and it's kind of just taken off from there.
Yeah, well, I'm gonna move to our next speaker, but I think one of some of the things that you've brought up in your intro are really interesting, and maybe they might be topics that we could dig down on if people were interested. Which is, it's sort of mentorship. It's also getting experience, like learning the ropes before you. This is a mixed metaphor, but learning the ropes before you fly, and also I think. Specific to Kodie, which is the same for Sarah, having a very particular voice, you know, like you've got a voice and a heritage and a background, and you're actually a really funny and really bright, and that comes across. And I think that is what people are connecting to there as well. So, you know, I think all of those things combined are all these little pieces that people gather along their way of actually making a career for themselves. So I am going to go now to our third speaker, who is, let me find my notes, Vanessa Alexander. Now, Vanessa is an award-winning writer and producer, most recently nominated for the American Writers Guild Awards for her work on Tony McNamara's series Great. That was for Best Comedy and Best New Series. And again, I just love that show. Okay, so actually they're my two favourite shows, Mystery Road and The Great were shows that got me through last year. Vanessa also wrote for an upcoming Netflix MGM series called Valhalla and has been made executive producer on that series. And she's also previously written on Tin Star for Sky Atlantic. She works in Australia, obviously, where she's been nominated for Writers Guild for The Wrong Girl. And she also wrote for Love Child. She was in The Room for the End and worked on a number of new projects for Easy Tiger. She spent her early part, I think it's fair to say the early part of her career, a decade, was in New Zealand, where she got nominated for Best Drama Series, Best Comedy Script, Best Short Film, Best New Filmmaker of the Year. There's quite a long list of awards for several projects that she did there, one being called Being Eve, which also got nominated for an international Emmy. I'm going to let Vanessa speak, but my favourite sentence from her CV sort of blurb is, with five children, two ex-husbands, four sisters, a foster son and a father she once helped jump bail, Vanessa is rarely short of inspiration for a story. So Vanessa, what was your inspiration towards becoming a storyteller?
I tried so hard to jump out from under my desk so that I could make the point that how you reveal the character is everything.
Oh, is that what you're saying? I'm just like blah, blah, blah.
I am. Yeah, that's such a complicated question. I definitely don't feel like I was lucky. I think that there's lots of moments that you have across your career that are kind of lucky, but actually it's a bit of a slog. So I've had a lot of, you know, I've had times that it's gone well and then times that it's not gone well. And I actually moved to Australia when I was 40 and I have five children. Well, I only had four then. And then I found out I was pregnant. And I also ended up acquiring a foster son who I'm related to. It was really, really hard to break into the industry here. I'd been directing for a decade. So I was a director for quite a long time. And sort of tried to I began as a writer, so I had to sort of return to that. And that was like a slog. It was a year of meetings, I think, I did before I ever even got into a writer's room. But I was thinking about like what is like useful to tell people. I mean, I think I've done a lot of tertiary education, and that's been quite helpful to me for just kind of like knowing how structure works and things like that. And you don't always have to follow it, but I think that was really useful. I definitely think I've worked in lots of writers' rooms, both as a director back in New Zealand and then eventually here. And I just about half of everything I know, I learned from other writers. So I have this kind of life philosophy, which is no position is too low if you can learn from it. Because it's like, I think you sort of, people get to a point and sometimes they're like, I just want to do my own stuff. I've never operated like that. And that's really paid off for me, I think, because, you know, like even recently doing The Great or some of the rooms I've done with Judy McCrossin. And at that point in my career, I actually knew quite a lot, but I learned so much from those people and Sam Strauss, and because everybody has their own different little insights and way of working. And in the end, you kind of acquire your own method by taking from different places. But
would you say that you started as a writer and then became a director, or were you primarily a director first and then?
No, I wrote a play when I was at university when I was 19, which is a feminist reinterpretation of T.S. Eliot's The Wasteland. Sounds important.
Ooh, hilarious, I mean, right?
Hilarious. It was a hilarious tale and incredibly optionable. You know, I was in that stage where, you know, you were in sort of performances naked and in glad wrap and pretending you're a placenta. So I am that play weirdly won a World Drama Trust International Playwriting Competition. And I was brought to London to do 3 weeks of workshops with the Royal Shakespeare Company. And weirdly, I was taught directing there by a young Phyllida Lloyd who did Mamma Mia, right? So the first person I ever saw direct was actually a woman. And so then I thought, maybe I'll do direct. And I sort of ended up sort of writing and directing. And then eventually I kind of got into jobbing directing. I had all those children to pay for. Eventually I was directing Power Rangers. And then during the Power Rangers, I started to like wake up in the middle of the night. Maybe this is useful to tell, because I call it the dream of, you know, the dream of the 100,000 vaginas, where my entire female ancestry would visit me in my sleep and go, why are you making a giant toy commercial for Disney? You're an idiot. You should be doing something about women or whatever. So, and I found that, like, I had that dream for like 2 years, and I eventually moved to Paris. I stopped directing. I moved to Paris and I taught at the International Film School there. And I studied I did 3 months with Philippe Goliere, you know, the clown who trained Sacha Baron Cohen. So while I was there, and he was just like, stop worrying about budgets, just write something that you care about. And what, so that was quite a good experience for me it sort of recentered me and made me think, you know, you get so caught up trying to please. I think when I started, you just, you know, you want to be good. You want somebody to tell you that you're good. I think women kind of, you know, I don't want to generalize, but I think that we're more inclined to wait to be anointed, right? And, you know, in my career, there were people that were like, this man is a genius, that man, he's a genius. There's always the young male genius. As a woman, you're emerging until you're 40 and then you're dead, right? and so, I think I feel like what happened for me was I kind of had to go through some process of addressing that it didn't really matter whether I was good. What mattered is that I had this level of education and really a position of privilege over, I mean, I'm my father was from poverty, but he's very educated. But really, I'm the first woman on that side of the family to have the level of education I had and the writing ability. And it's like in the end, does it really matter if I'm good, or does it just matter that I try and make an effort to tell stories that I think are important and stop worrying what the hell other people think? Because then at least the 100,000 vaginas behind me will be happy.
I'm curious though that there's a few sort of points coming up, and also that at what age do you feel like you always had this kind of sense of like, oh, well, I'm just going to go for it? Or do you feel like that there was a certain age where you just sort of went, oh, I'm just done. I'm just going to go for this thing that I feel like the vaginas are telling me to do. So
I feel like, no, that didn't really happen until my late 30s. But I think I did have a lot of energy to make stuff happen when I was young. But I was a mom when I was really young as well. So that, this is not advice, audience. This is not advice to have a child when you're young. So please practice contraception. But I do think that because I had a child when I was young, you have to put some of your angst aside because you just need a friggin' job, right? So I... like in that sense, it was a little bit helpful, but then it also means that you end up just going, oh my God, I've got bills to pay. I'm going to do Power Rangers, which I learned from. I'm not sorry for it, but it's like in the end, I sort of shifted away from what it is that I wanted to talk about as a person. And it was a very conscious thing to kind of return to that. And what was good about it, I think, is that I had to go through this crisis where I felt like I was too old. I was like, I'm too old to restart my career in Australia. And I sort of had to go, like I went and saw a therapist and I was like, I need you to fix my brain. I need you to take out the thought that I'm too old and instead put the thought in that I've never been better than I am now. I've never known more than I know now. I've never had more life experience than I've had now. And it changed the way I interviewed for jobs, right? Like, because before I used to talk about previous things that I'd done. And then somehow through that process, I actually just started going, how do I connect with this material personally, right? So like when they interviewed me for The Great, I just thought like, I mean, obviously Tony had written the pilot and everything. And I read the pilot and you just, in that meeting, I never really talked about what I did. I talked about the fact that I'd separated from my husband 4 months before and that he was writing a show about a woman who wanted to kill hers, right? And if you can find the thing that is your personal connection to the material, that's your most interesting point of view you could bring. And it probably also improved me as a writer.
I mean, I think that's really true. We're going to, that's amazing. Like that was a really such a great introduction to you and your background. We're going to open up to the whole panel now and start answering some of these questions that have come from the Q&A. So if people have more questions, write them up in that Q&A box that's there. And if someone's already asked the same question that you were going to ask, like it, then it goes to the box, the top of the box, and it's easier for someone like me to ask the first question from the Q&A box, which is location important? Can you work as well regionally, or do you need to be based in Sydney and Melbourne? I feel like maybe, Kodie, you could start, if you wouldn't mind, with that one.
I mean, I at the moment live in the Blue Mountains, which... isn't that, I mean, it's an 2 hour, I live 2 hours from Sydney. So I found that even though this pandemic was absolutely horrible, it absolutely helped me in a way that I could prove to producers I could work regionally and work from home. And there's just nothing better than being home and doing a like Zoom room. I know people have their opinions about Zoom rooms, but I like the fact that I can get up and put my washing on the line in the 10-minute break. So I really enjoyed that. And the fact that I didn't have to go on trains every day. So I think producers are beginning to realize, oh, we can definitely hire writers outside of the Sydney, Melbourne bubble. And because we don't have to pay for accommodation. Yay, because numbers. So I've kind of seen the shift change and I spend way more time now home in the Blue Mountains, which is great for me, than I do in Sydney. And even like Brisbane, I've been working the last 3 months in Brisbane because we've actually been on set, so I had to be there. So Brisbane's becoming a really big hub and the Gold Coast for new sort of storytelling and filming.
Yeah, I mean, I feel like that's true now that you're a bit more established. I don't know.
When I first thought it was handy being in Sydney because I was a note taker. And I'd get the call last minute and say, I'm like, yep, I'm available this week. I can do that. So I was able to do a lot more networking. And I hate to say it, but it is who you know. You get recommended word of mouth. So lots of networking and through those, not just doing writers' rooms, but also networking events and just meeting people that way. So I hate being social, but sometimes you just have to. You have to take one for the team.
I lied about where I lived. So I just want to say that I lied. I live in Newcastle because that's where the father of my kids is, right? And I didn't realize when I moved from Paris that it looked like 45 minutes on the train, on European trains, but it's actually like 2.5 hours. And I just knew I'd never get booked or anything. So I just lied. I told everybody I lived in Sydney. And for the first year, and eventually I got work. And now I feel like once you break through, then they'll be like, oh, okay, we'll pay your accommodation. But I used to just pay it out of my fees. And then I started getting work and I went over to London and spent a bit of time there. And then when I left there, I lied and I told them that I still lived in London, even though I lived in Australia. So I had to book jobs where I was covering my own flights. I've done it twice. And now they pay for my flights. But, you know, it's.
So, yeah, I mean, that would sort of indicate that. I mean, I feel a bit the same as Kodie. Sarah, do you have a feeling on this one? You're born in Sydney, right?
Yeah, I'm in complete agreement. I think it's a nice idea that you can live anywhere, but you need to build the network before you can do that. If you happen to meet someone like Vanessa and you live in Newcastle, then maybe you won't need to. But yeah, I think it's that's the tricky thing. I'm looking at a lot of these questions and it's all like, how do you get the first break and what do you do with your script? And it's like, that's the hardest part. You need to be super resilient. You need to be in it for a long haul. And once you get those first opportunities, things will change. It might take a while, but they will.
Yeah. I feel like we're going to, just to end that thing, given that I've lived in Sydney for years as well, but I did, I did come from Western Australia and I'm back in Perth a lot to see my family. And I know that, you know, it does sort of feel a lot like, you know, Brisbane, Sydney, Melbourne are where everything is happening. But there are incredible filmmaking networks in every city. So, and I think particularly if you're starting, connecting to those grassroots and actually here even in out west, just connecting to grassroots writing groups and communities like that is a really good place to start. We've got a lot of questions which are about... I've got this one about a pack. I don't even know what a pack is. Does anyone on the panel know what a pack is? Like a putting your work forward? Is that like a...
I think I do.
Scripts? Do you know, Vanessa?
I think that what they mean by that is like, it's like when students leave film school, it's like, what is a thing that you can put together that's representative of your work? Like, is it a spec script? Is it a... And I saw one go past about whether or not original voice is... more important or whatever now. And I don't know what you guys think, but this is my answer to that. Original voice is more important. And like it used to be when I, 20 years ago that you could go write a CSI spec script and kind of, but that's not really how it is anymore. They're much more concerned with voice and authenticity of voice. And I did a PhD, which I've nearly finished, maybe one day. But as part of my PhD, I wrote a pilot script and I jokingly call that script the script that got me 1,000 jobs. And it's never been made, but it's got me a lot of work. And the thing that I think that I did that was really smart about that is I didn't overthink it. I didn't go, is it easier? I hear people go, there's more work in crime, so I will do a crime thing. I actually just did what I thought I would do really well. And it's a comedy drama, right? About a mother waking up having lost 20 years of her memory and just thinking, why the fuck am I married with two children? And it literally got me the job on Vikings. Like, it could not be further from the genre. So just do what you can do well. And one script is enough. It's just gotta be like, be true to your voice.
Yeah, I agree. I've never written a spec script for another show in my life. Kodie, Sarah, you got?
I did it once because I was doing a course online. So people who are regional, this might be a good course for you. It does cost a bit, but I think it's still cheaper than AFTERS. UCLA has an online writer's program, and you can specialize in either TV or film, and you can either in the TV strand do half hour or hour. And there it's split into three segments or trimesters, whatever. And the first time you write a spec script, and you have to do it on an existing show. And weirdly, that got me work. But I would say most people are interested in original voice, and Vanessa's now like, be true. Don't write what you think's gonna get you work. Write what you fucking wanna write. Sorry, what do you want to write?
When I have general meetings with when producers request to like meet with me, if you want to see my work, a sample of my work, I have my Mystery Road script or my play, and like 100% of the time they will always choose my play because they want to see what my original voice is, basically.
Yeah, I think that seems right. There was one question about format. I mean, script writing is pretty standard, so I think you have to write it in the script format in Final Draft. It's a universal language and a universal program, and that's how people are going to want you to deliver it. And that is actually how a script needs to go into production like that. So it's a really boring kind of thing. I quite like this question. I'm just freeforming on the Q&A panel here now. About imposter syndrome. I feel like that for women, given this is a female driven, I think it's a really good question, and I'm gonna put that to the panel and then have a read of all more specific questions. Maybe Vanessa, since you got your
I just feel like I honestly feel like it's what I came to see, and it's not like I've suffered from that, like just like everybody, but I came to see that it's ludicrously self-centered. And that if you're indulging that, then you actually, you need to stop and think, like, there's like women before you who were like dying in childbirth and like, you know, no one had a dishwasher. And I mean, I look at my grandmother's life and it was just completely shite, right? And I feel like once I stepped back from myself, I thought, you know, just get over yourself, get over it, because your life is not that hard, right? Like, it's all you've got to do is write a script. What is the worst they're going to say? They're going to say it's shit. And who knows if they even know? I mean, like, I've had feedback on scripts from like, particularly with stuff that's quite gender related. Like, one of my favorite notes I've ever received is from a man who read the what I call the script that got me the 1,000 jobs, which is essentially about the fact that at 22, you know, the character, the last thing they remember is going on stage with their band, right? And they wake up to find they're still living next door to their mother with two kids, right? And what a shit life that is. And I literally had a man go, I don't think a woman who woke up and found out she was married with children would feel upset about that at all, right? And it's like, you've got like, you can take that as a criticism, or you can just go, well, that's what I want to talk about. I want to talk about how marriage and motherhood is not entirely satisfying. And if you're the kind of person who can't see that, divorce is coming for you. I shouldn't say that, but it's, I feel like you've got to like defocus from your own self-centered feelings of wanting approval and think, I am part of this bigger picture of women everywhere who need to get their stories out there because they weren't there for us when we were growing up.
I mean, that is like the most amazing answer to that question, Kodie. And Sarah, do you have anything to add to this incredible piece of advice that Vanessa just gave these people?
I mean, I kind of feel shame now, like fuck off. I'll go just go fuck myself then, Vanessa.
So I don't know if anybody on the panel or in the audience loves, but I adore Mandy Kaling, and she put up a post saying, just act with the confidence of a straight white man. Like, my parents instilled that in me. And I think that's a good lesson for life.
Yeah. I mean, it's not imposter syndrome. I always fear being invisible, particularly in a box. What I actually go through most weeks of my career is I get offered jobs only because they've got an Indigenous character or an Indigenous cultural thread that they need to tick a box. And I'm like, is this all I'm good for? Really? Like, I can write other stuff, but I don't feel like some people believe that. And, you know, I'm desperate to write. You can give me a rich white person. I can imagine to be rich and white. I can imagine to be like Catherine the Great, you know, just because I'm a black fella from a remote community. So I think that's kind of the syndrome I suffer from. And it's unfortunately very real because these are the jobs I get offered. But it is changing, and it's people sort of recognize what I can do. I mean, I've always known I've been like the only black fella in writers' rooms. When I was directing, though, that kind of just blew my mind. It was the first time I felt female, and I was told by a very male set, oh, you need to smile more. And I'm like, what? And the advice I got from producers, oh, Cody, you just need to throw your dick on the table. And I'm like, I don't have a dick, so please don't tell me that. And I was talking to my mentor in the States, and I'm like, how do you deal with like men talking over you constantly? And she just gave me advice. She's like, you just got to have the confidence to just go, excuse me, can you just let me finish? And so now I use that this week, actually, in a writer's room when men were talking over me, because it happens weekly. They know not to do it anymore.
Yeah, it's true though, isn't it? You know, I've had men tell me in rooms what women would think, and I'm literally the only woman in the room, and he's going, how are you guys the experts on this particular subject? I mean, I don't want to speak for all women, but I feel I can speak for some of them more than you can speak for any of them. But I wonder whether, and this is going a little bit off topic, but I wonder, going back to what you were saying, Vanessa, as well, about that thing about the producer who said that a woman who had two children would wake up and be satisfied and happy, but that the changing landscape has meant that women are telling their own stories. And so the idea that that might be a story that is going to be told is kind of changing as well.
Yeah, no, it's true. And I also want to pick up on something that Kodie said. Like, I think that there is a thing like that. I mean, I feel like I was a tick box for women. Like, I did lots of writers' rooms where I was the only woman, and it was like, okay, you can be the woman's voice. And I'm actually the first woman to write Vikings, right? And I was the only woman in that writer's room. But I'm pleased to let you know that the next season has three. So, you know, like, in a way, I kind of feel like that's our job. Like, I kind of knew when I came into that room that I had more license to go, I don't like what they wanted more of my commentary about the female characters than they wanted. And interestingly, it was partly by agreement, but I didn't take the episodes in that season that were massive action pieces. All of them have action, but I did a sort of some of the episodes that were more character. But in the end, no one cared. Like, once you've actually, it's just getting in, like, I feel like our job is just like, just crawl through that window and then like just get it up for someone else, right?
Absolutely. Yeah. The best advice also that I got was, well, if they're going to use you, you use them. Mm-hmm. And I went, oh, and I did. I used their resources. I'm like, what other rooms you got? What other jobs you got for me? So it's just about getting in and just mutually, if you're going to take from me, I'll take from you in a nice way.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Bass, did you have anything to add to this incredible advice, I feel like?
Well, and I think the thing is, well, building on everything that's being said about like imposter syndrome, women waiting to be overqualified, whatever. I'm a believer of however you get in the fucking room, get in the room. Like Kodie was saying, use them. The exact same advice was given to me. But I think also be a bit bolshy in if you are being used, like, you can tell them you're aware of the situation. Like I was in a room very much because they were all white and had never even met a Muslim person. Definitely no one could speak any Arabic, and they were writing a show all about Arabs. And like I got told things like, but Sarah isn't an Arab name. Like just crazy shit. That, so there were great people involved in that show who I could trust and who I built up a strong relationship with and who were mentored me. And towards the end of it, I was like, cool, well, I've given you guys a lot like of cultural stuff. And it's been great and I've learned heaps, but what are you giving me back? I need credit, because at the end of the day, experience is fantastic, not to be undervalued, but this industry is all about credits. And so what's the credit you're giving me? And I think women aren't great at doing that. We feel a bit uncomfortable doing that. And you know what? Men they have no fucking problem. Every dude I've met in this industry thinks they deserve more credits. So if you do get the chance, you know, use your network to figure out how to ask that question. Don't be backward in coming forward about trying to get a credit. If it doesn't work out, don't be bitter, be gracious, but like ask the question.
Yeah, I think that's a really good, really good point. And I think it does also lead, because one of the things I've found that men, and it's not just me, like this is a universally agreed upon thing, is that men are better at asking for more money than women are. And I can see quite a few people are asking sort of questions that are about, and I'm going to combine some of these questions, things like working with producers and optioning a script, and should I get an agent? And you know, I'm sort of combining that with, you know, how do I ask for what I want, including a fair wage? So I maybe just go around again and see what people's experiences are with that kind of, you know, that sort of those sort of questions when you're emerging, and they do feel really, you know, complicated, like how do I trust this person, do I need an agent, how do I option something. Maybe Bass will start with you on that one, because I feel like you've got a few projects that are at that point.
Yep. Well, I'm the laziest person around when it comes to like life admin. So yes, I encourage getting an agent. They will take 15% of your money, and I happily give it. How did I get an agent? Look, it was, again, the network, super lucky. I had a friend who was a junior in an agency. She was studying at AFTERS the same time as I was studying at AFTERS. She read all my shit. She was like, these are great. Can I show my boss? I was like, yes, that would be great. The boss read it, we met. And then I asked some other people to introduce me to agents so that I could meet a few. And I was very fortunate that people were happy to make that introduction. And I ended up going with my friend's agent. She was who I trusted the most. And what were the other things I was meant to talk about?
I guess it's maybe we'll... I've made it maybe too big of a question. Maybe we should just start with agents, because then it's sort of working with producers and learning how to trust and who to trust. So I don't know. I don't actually know, Vanessa and Kodie, what your situations are with agents or not agents.
I can talk. I got an agent by being drunk in a bar and telling stories about what a terrible mother I was. And this woman gave me her card, and it turned out she was from RGM. She was like, I think I can help you. And she did help me. And I actually have an agent in the UK. And then I have some people that are now trying to help me in the US. But the what I am going to tell you is that I had an agent when I was younger, because I was the original When Working Title offered their screenwriting, they had this sort of internship for screenwriters at 30, when I was 32, I got it. And I want to tell you that I got, you'll soon learn that I've got terrible stories about how I cheat, because I met Tim Bevan in a bar and I asked him for it, and that's how I got it. So I bought him a beer. I was like, because he's also a New Zealander. But when I was at Working Title, they organized an agent for me in the UK. And I felt like, so the first thing is, it's really hard to get an agent. So don't like get too excited about it. But they miraculously organized this agent. And I thought, oh, this is going to be great. My career is going to take off, all of this sort of stuff. And I fucked that up so badly. So that when I came back to having an agent again, after the drunk bar story at 40, I actually didn't. And I now, so my advice to you is this, is that one, it's going to be really hard to get an agent. And two, if you do get one, it's not their job to find you work, right? It's a partnership between two people. They don't want you if you aren't going to work really hard and you're just going to wing up and whine and say you're going to, you know, why haven't I been put forward? They want people with scripts that they can take out there, and they try and sell you. And I actually think the most important thing to learn how to do is close the deal. Because when an agent, when an agency gets something in, like from another show, Vikings the Great, whatever, they can't put all their writers forward. They can only put forward like two or three. And how do they choose those two or three writers? They choose them because those people close the deal. They get the job in the interview. And so like when I began, you know, like I feel like you're just like a little flea on the ass of an agency. And basically you get lucky to get forward, put forward to anything. But if you go and you interview well and you do those interviews really well and they get good feedback, you get put forward to better and better jobs.
Yeah, I think that's actually really true. And being funny and being nice and being kind of, you know, having something to say in those interviews. Kodie, do you have an agent?
I do. And basically through networks, it was a friend asked me. I was still about in emerging stage. I'd written for Mystery Road. I didn't have an agent in my first script of that. And a friend of mine said, do you have an agent? I'm like, no, can you introduce me? And they were happy to, and met with them. But also I would, even working with producers, agents, you've got to make sure that you're on the same page. Like I liken it to a marriage. You're interviewing for a marriage, and I need to know that my agent's got my back and recommending me. Like, I also agree with Vanessa, agents aren't there to get you jobs, you get the jobs. But I need to know that if something comes in, a request for me, they will often go, I don't think you're right for this, or I don't think you'll like this. I'll still read it and I'll be like, yes, they know my taste. They know what I like. In terms of like generals with different producers and broadcasters out there, I am quite upfront with what I like. I give them what I've been watching, what I enjoy about that show. So my angle is always like, Buffy is what I got me in here. So I like strong female character driven shows. And if they've got a bit of kick-ass action to it, I'm your girl. So that's kind of what I like to, plus I write for comedy and drama. So I'm a bit of a, what I call a genre slut for that. So I like to not be pigeonholed into one thing, but the thing that always, and I tell this to producers, I tell this to the agent, the thing that will draw me to a show is a character. I need to cling on to a character. And if I can't, I'm probably not your person.
Yeah, I think that's right. Just quickly to fill in the gap then, because everyone's sort of going, what's an agent going to do if they're not going to get your work? But once you've landed the job, an agent, every contract that you get is different, and an agent is going to be the one who's going to be able to negotiate your contract and also be that sounding board for your career.
And they set up all your meetings. Like yeah. That year of meetings that I did, where I traveled down from Newcastle one day every week and just tried to do some more, they were all organized by the agent. Like it's much easier to get those meetings with an agent, but you have to make that meeting work.
Yeah. And also it is a really tricky thing because you need to have some value to the agency as well before they'll take you on. So they're not going to take someone on just because they like you. They're going to take someone on because they think they're going to be able to get some work out of you in the nicest possible way. Look, let's just stick with, because I am going to go back to what the difference between writing in Australia and the US is, because that seems to be answering a lot of questions. The one that's at the, I'm just going to say that the Q&A question that's at the top of the list, which is, once you have a spec script but no contacts, what should be your next step? I think it's a really tricky one, and hopefully we'll come back to it maybe at the end, but I feel like we're, and Ken's putting some things there, but I feel like hopefully this conversation will help you with that, because there is no answer to that question. Everyone's got a different answer to that one, and you know, it's a life experience, and it's gaining all these things, and hopefully all together we'll try and find the answer. But let's stick with working with producers. How do you guys work with the producers that you work with? Like, do you tend to work with the same ones? Do you worry about them optioning things? Okay, Vanessa.
I've not always done that so well. Like, I actually feel like that's something I could be pickier about. Because I think there is an inclination as a writer to be like, oh my God, I'm so relieved to have a job. So obviously you don't pick the producers when you come onto a show. So I've always, and I really treasure that process of, I'm happy to work for other people. I don't have to be the lead. I love other people's ideas and contributing to them. So then you're not choosing the producer. It's with your own idea. I mean, I definitely think you want somebody who loves the work. So, but I also think there's nothing more frustrating than having a project with somebody who doesn't have the ability to finance that kind of project. And I feel like, agents can be important in advising you about that, and it's good to be careful about it. I'll tell you something funny. I think that Australian writers are really, really good. They're really good. Like, I've done all, in the last few years, I pretty much only worked out of the UK, and I don't think I've ever worked with anyone who is as good as an Australian writer. They're really like, the everybody here in the rooms, they're so generous and like full of ideas. And so British producers really like them. Like, yeah. So I feel like, you know, British producers and Australian writers are quite happy together. It's like two people leaving a bad marriage.
It's true. I've worked in UK writers' rooms, and they're terrible. Kodie, how do you choose your collaborators in that way?
Just like, I'm dating. Like, I've actually learnt from my mistakes. I've taken original work to someone who I thought was the right producer, but it ended up they weren't, because we both had different ideas of what the show was. And that was a big lesson for me. Like, oh, okay, even though this producer's really big, they actually don't see what I see in this show and what the tone is and what the style is and basically what the core question is. So we mutually decided, it wasn't messy, we just sat down and realized this. We mutually decided to go separate ways, and I found a producer that did. And I just like producers that are funny and can take a joke and don't take themselves so seriously. And, you know, we all have to spend long days on set or long days in writer's room. And then sometimes it's like therapy, sharing all these traumatic stories, because why else are we friggin' writers? But, you know, it's good to laugh. And of course, the third thing is driven, someone that's going to be out there like driving your project. There's nothing worse, and I've worked with them, than a lazy producer that just like sits and waits. I expect myself included for me to go out there and be pitching stuff. So yeah, that's kind of what I look for.
Yeah. And Bass, have you had, because I think one of the things that's really important from those points is finding a producer that both matches creatively but also who matches at your experience level and the experience level that you need that producer to be at to get the show up. Have you had any experiences, Bass, where you've had a mismatch in that way or?
Definitely. I think the key thing is making sure that the producer gets what you want the show to be. You guys have like a shared vision. If they don't have that, I know it's so tempting to just like the allure, whatever, of getting your thing optioned is really strong, but it's not worth it. It will just end in pain, agony, and tears. But when you find the right one, boom, orgasm central. When it's wrong, they can be a lovely person. Like what I find interesting about coming from the legal profession, where no one really gives a fuck what your personality is like. It's like, how do you work? We can hate each other, but we work well together. Like the first thing you get asked there is, how do you like to work? No one seems to ask that question here. It's in this industry I'm talking about, weird. And everybody's like, oh, they're so nice. Great, that's great. I don't wanna work with assholes. No matter what I'm doing, I don't wanna hang out with assholes. This is why I struggled watching Succession. And, you know, but like, so I've worked with, everyone I've worked with is a lovely person, but we haven't communicated the same way. Like, I, as you might have been able to guess, I'm an anal control freak, I'd like you to respond to emails if they're sent. Some millennials, like I said, I was 33, going back to film school. There was, you know, it can be tricky. So I think know yourself, know what works for you. Then that way you can make that clear. The problems seem to arise when expectations aren't met. So be clear about what you expect and don't be scared to walk away if it's not right.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. So it's a complicated kind of question. All right, we're going to go to...
I was going to add something that might be, because I saw a question go past about a few times about how do you protect your work and stuff like that. And I just want to like, I think that's a really common thing that people ask. And I want to tell you this little story, which is when I was working at Working Title in the screenwriting internship, there was a cupboard near my desk. And it was like a cupboard and it had those big gray folders and it had two for every letter of the alphabet. And in those folders was a 2-page script report, right? That had been written for coverage. And like, so, you know, I actually have saved some of them. Like one of them is the turndown. They turned down Bend It Like Beckham. So like I looked through and I was like, I used to reread them to make myself feel better. Like, see, they turned down really good stuff. But basically those script folders were absolutely jam packed with 2-page script reports for material that had been sent in to be either to be read. And they only accepted, you know, they wouldn't take unsolicited. So they're all from agents. And those folders were for the last 3 years and the years before that were down in the basement. And I remember thinking, holy shit, like if we had this many people working on world peace, the world would be a good place. Instead, they're all trying to write screenplays. And what I came to realize, and they had this list of projects that they were tracking, is that everything that you have ever thought of is already being written somewhere else, right? Like, don't waste your time thinking they're gonna steal my idea, right? You'll be lucky that someone else hasn't already had it in Sydney. Your job is not to hold on to your 4-line idea. Like, if you watch The Great, there's probably a bunch of things that were done about Catherine the Great, but what Tony had was like a completely unique take and voice on that. And that can't be replicated. And anybody that read that script would never steal it. You'd just be like, we want to hire that guy. So I think, you know, just be aware that like, obviously things can be taken, but it's actually happens much less than I think anyone, than it's not been my experience. If you turn up with a good script, people want it. They don't want to just get rid of you.
Yeah.
And I think I'd add on to that. We're in the ideas business. If you only have one idea and you're worried and petrified about one idea, I hate to be brutal, but you're not a writer. You're a person with one idea.
It's true. It's true. It's 100% true. We are really running out of time. There's a question here, and I guess it's kind of that thing of like, what's the best way to start? Like, if you're a person who's a writer and a producer and a director and you want to be a writer, do you think it's better to focus your career on the one thing that you want, or just sort of go for it as a slashy? What do you think? Anyone? Who's a slashy? Are you a slashy, Vanessa?
I'm a slashy. I was a director for a long time. I just think it was complete madness. Like, I've got producing credits, directing credits, and they're like, I'm like Kodie, I'm comedy. I'm now writing Vikings. Like, they're completely, it's ridiculous. Like, it's the worst career plan anyone has ever had, right? But I wouldn't advise anyone to do it, but it's complicated. You just, the different jobs are there. I mean, it's like I joked to you before about Power Rangers, but I'm absolutely certain that it played into how I got that role on Vikings. Because even though they read a comedy drama script, they went, oh, she's written something. She's directed some action before, right? And they slid me past. You can't know how and what's going to be useful. And I think, I think sometimes writing is the better path because it allows you to have and sort of show original voice more easily than being a jobbing director. But I think it's like everyone has to crawl through their own path. I got a job as a producer because I wrote and directed a low budget feature for $200,000 and I had trouble getting distribution, and it was picked up by the New Zealand International Film Festival. And they buried it on like page 70 of the booklet. So I bought all 700 tickets on credit cards and did a press release saying it was the first film to sell out in the festival. And then I had to sell $7,000 worth of tickets to pay the card back, right? With two kids out of my friggin' house in Grey Lynn. And then I did it again in Wellington. And from that, the film got distribution. And then I got invited to a conference where they asked me how the film had got distribution. And I told the truth that I'd basically, and then I got offered a job as a producer. So you don't really know where anything's going to lead. You just have to go. What you've got to know is it's a fight. You know, if you think it's going to come on a plate, it's not, because it just isn't. You've got to get out there and, I don't know, I think I've cheated and done some, you know? Go sit on that producer's car. Like, hi, here I am.
Yeah, I think that's really true. You've got to be in it. You've got to be in it to win it.
I think the thing is, do whatever the fuck you want to do, all of it. But when you're starting out at least and applying for jobs, just be a bit smart about your CV. So if you're applying for a writer's attachment and you're a slashy, just put the stuff that's relevant to being a writer's attachment. Like, don't make it easy for people to say no. Once you're started, who gives a fuck? But just, like, I think just be smart when you are sending out that initial CV.
Yeah, I think that is a very good piece of advice. Look, this question is at the top of the list, but I'm not sure that any of us are able to answer it, which is navigating a career of writing in Australia v the US. I don't have a career in the US. Vanessa?
I only have the accent. I left when I was 14 and a half. No, I have a manager there, but I only took them on right before COVID. So I don't really know that well how that works. Only the UK. Like, I've sort of broken into that quite well, but yeah, not the US yet.
Yeah, no.
Yet. I'm getting it. I'm going to get that.
Yeah, look out.
Marvel better watch out. After Vikings, it's what I want. Wonder Woman, except that's not Marvel, that's DC.
Look out. Okay, there's a lot of discussion about, let's just quickly answer these questions about how difficult it is for older women to make it as a screenwriter. I feel like that the conversation we've been having is that your limitation is your own, like that age. It's a little bit like that question of how do I get a script from the, anyway, I'm answering the question, I should throw it to the panel. Do we have any insight? I feel like it's the same. It's the same question of being over 60, over 50, or being over 20. Like, how do you make it it's having an original.
Really hard to sleep your way to the top anymore.
That's right.
No, sorry. You gotta hold on to what I held on to, that the older that you are, the more you know, the more it's easier to write a teenager at 50 than it is for a teenager to write a teenager. Because even though there's like specific things to now that you might be a bit out of touch with, it's being able to stand back from your life that gives you the insight, right?
Yeah. Yeah. Do you guys have any insight? This sort of kind of connects. There's a question about getting a writer's room to be a note taker. And Kodie and Sass, since you both are kind of closest to that, maybe one of you could answer that question. Kodie, I think it was being given to you there.
Sass. I can't remember. It was that long. I feel like it was that long ago. I was so new that I contacted a producer to say, I'll do anything. Like, I'll make your cup of tea. And basically I got the gig with Ready For This, but you came in a little bit earlier, Liz, and showed me like how you like the notes set out. And I just took it from there and I'm like, right, I'm going to be the best note taker ever. And so that was kind of my attitude. And from there, got recommended to other rooms. So it was just about, offering my services. But now there's actually specific, I think, I want to say courses that I know the Writers Guild has ran about what to do as a note taker and running that. So maybe check out if they're running anytime soon, Bass.
Yeah, I think, it's a bit of luck trying to get that first note-taking gig. And it's tricky if you don't have like a film school or somebody already in the industry. But if you go to those events and you meet somebody and they offer you to like say, hey, let's have a coffee, or give you their email or whatever, don't send them your a trillion pages of scripts. Be like, hey, can you get me in as an observer? Can you get me in as a note taker? If you do get a gig as a note taker, go to the head writer, ask them how they like things formatted. A table of contents at the beginning of the notes, every fucking writer will think you are the best note taker that has ever existed. Be pleasant. No matter how much you hate the job and it's hard, because personally, I think note taking is the hardest job in the room. Yep. Just be as preppy as you fucking can be and funny, and just keep your mouth shut when they're talking about ideas for the first few days. When you get the opportunity to talk about yourself at the breaks, do that with zest. Tell everyone how great they are. Just, play that card and you will get asked back and then the next opportunity and the next opportunity.
Yeah, I think that's right. And also, you can, that's that thing, you can find the name and number of every production company in your city just by Googling. So and usually the person who's the contact is also the person who's your contact to become an observer in a room or a note taker in a room anyway. So it's not like you need to ask this from the top producer, because they genuinely don't care who is observing in their rooms. I mean, they don't want everyone, but you know what I mean? Like, the person who's going to get you that gig is going to be the person who's going to answer your email anyway.
And sorry, just to add on that, and if you do get a chance, really do try and move heaven and earth to take that chance. I know it's difficult, but like, I remember the first room I had for Liz, I was meant to be doing a part-time job. I called everyone to find someone to cover my shift. And the second day I just called in sick. Do whatever you can do, because then Liz and I clicked, we got on really well, and she was so great. She, when I emailed her and was like, hey, I'm running out of work and money, do you know of any jobs? She very kindly emailed writer friends who was like, I've got a note taker who is good. Here she is. employ her, and they did. So if you don't, you know, if you don't take that first chance, it's really hard. You might be waiting a while to get a second one.
That's true. I mean, good note takers, there's a little secret list going around of people who are good, and that's how people get out of work.
Do whatever you can to, though, is also true for writing. It's true for all of it, I think. That is such a good point, because like it doesn't, there's so many opportunities that are just they're a pain in the ass, right? Like when I did The Great, it was in bow roll. I was 3 months following my separation with my ex, having been married for 22 years. I had 3 children at home, including a 5-year-old that was about to start school. And I had to leave every morning and drive from Newcastle, every Monday morning and drive from Newcastle at 4 o'clock in the morning to drive down to Balroll, live down there for 4 days a week. I did this for 6 weeks. And then I would drive back on Friday night, see my children, right? And I remember just thinking, I just got to suck it up for 6 weeks because this job looks really good, right? Vikings, when the writer's room for that, I had to take my children. I had nobody to look after them. I was just like, fuck it, we're going on the plane. And I flew to Ireland and I took 3 children with me to that room. I just thought, I'm gonna solve it. I don't care, like whatever. They can just learn no maths for the week. I'll, you know, bring their little violins and make them practice, you know? So you've gotta, when opportunities present themselves, you've gotta take them.
Wow, that is inspiring, actually. That is very, very inspiring.
And the kids survive it. Like somebody had a question about mother guilt. I feel permanently guilty. Don't worry about it. You know, call me up. I'll take for a drink.
Yeah, there's something for that. It's called wine. So look, I think these things about, does anyone have an experience with adapting a novel to a screenplay? I mean, I do. It's a nightmare. I sometimes feel I'm not on the panel, but I'm going to answer this question. I'm a moderator. I'm just stepping in. Sometimes you just think, oh, this effort to change a novel, like I could have written you a script in the amount of time we've spent trying to undo all the stuff that's not working in this novel. But does anyone on the panel, has anyone ever successfully adapted a novel? No.
Nope.
There's your answer.
Sorry, I should say I'm working on a show that did successfully adapt a novel. The novel's done, so it, whatever. But I can say this tip of that came from the writer who did adapt it is you need to really respect the novel itself. If you don't, you're just, again, setting yourself up for a lot of hard work and misery.
Yeah, interesting.
Wrong Girl was a novel, but we moved, you know, that basically the majority of the story of that was used in the pilot. So you're using characters, but usually I feel like if it's a novel to television, my one experience is that you're taking the characters and you're sort of making that world bigger than it is in the novel.
Yeah, I was going to say the first job I did in the UK was based on a novel. I forget the name of the show. That's terrible. But basically we threw away the story and kept all the characters. So it really depends on what the brief is for the novel and how famous the novel is, like how much, you know, how many fans of the novel are going to be out there, or whether you can just kind of, you know, use it as a jumping board. Actually, I feel like I skipped over this question because I'm seeing behind you, Bass, all sorts of script notes written on a mirror. And there's a question here that says, I'm visual more than dialogue, which is a little bit of a worry. Dialogue is important in script writing. But when you ladies write, are there any other ways you visualize the script? And I think that there are, and they're maybe quickly worth talking about, Bass, because you've got one right behind you.
I'm obsessed with whiteboards. Put everything up on a whiteboard, and I love, I mean, it's how I also did my legal cases. So I've got dyslexia, and so everything's spelt wrong, but I like to have things up, rub them out, move them around, scene by scene. Again, when I'm writing in final draft, I split it so I have the page, but also on the side, scenes so I can see how things fit together and color code. Is that what you mean?
No, all of that stuff, like cards, whiteboards, music, charts.
I have a playlist for everything I'm working on because I find it hard to switch between projects if I don't have something to get me in the mood.
Kodie, you were nodding.
Oh, I do all that, all of the above. I love putting cards on the wall. I mean, I'm rent because I'll never be able to afford a house, but basically the trick is not to peel your paint off if you're in a rental. So be careful about that. I listen to a lot of film music. If I have writer's block, my trick is to just go in an antique store and just walk around touching stuff. Like, I love living and seeing things and touching things. The other day, I went through a hike through the Blue Mountains. I was like by myself in this national park, and I played the Game of Thrones soundtrack, and that was spinny. Like, I totally felt I was on a different planet. I felt like I was Cersei about to burn down the whole forest. So whatever works for you. But that one was new for me. I think I'll keep doing that.
Oh my God. Okay, I feel like one of those people that the ABC News is about to come on. Vanessa, do you have a last minute kind of, how do you get, because then we're going to have to wrap it up. But
I use whiteboards and everything to plan as well. But I like, my thing is music. I can play the piano and the violin, and I weirdly play in a really great ukulele orchestra here in Newcastle. And I love music because I feel like there's, for me, like a symphony and television are kind of the same. It's like the themes keep coming back. But if it was played on a violin, then when it comes back, it's got to come back on the oboe. You need the counterpoint. Like, I love to think about it musically. And sometimes finding the theme song of something really gives you the tone. So yeah, that's my thing.
I love all of those. Yeah, Miranda Deer always talked about scripts as an orchestra as well. And I love that idea. Like, you know, you've got to build to a climax. And okay, Jeannie, we're done. I believe we have to stop talking. So I'm throwing back to you.
Oh, I'm about to wrap up with a very heavy heart because that was a superb conversation. And every time I do one of these sessions, and we've done a few now focusing on different areas of the industry, and every time we get to the end of them, I then want to be the role that's been discussed. And today, now, I want to be a screenwriter, and I know it's difficult, and I know there's a lot of people out there that want to do it too. But I just think this conversation has really addressed a lot of the things that I know people who are watching today want to know about. So I would like to thank you all, our incredibly talented and articulate panel, for sharing their experiences with us this afternoon. I'm sure there's a lot of you out there who will have gained insight and inspiration into what it takes to be a screenwriter. So a huge and heartfelt thanks to our speakers, Kodie Bedford, Vanessa Alexander and Sarah Bass. I'm not even going to go there with your surname, Sarah, because it's very hard to pronounce. And of course, to our excellent moderator, Liz Doran, who I think you'll agree has guided us through a beautiful conversation today. Thanks everyone for joining us, and we'll see you next time.